that you give and the joy that you bring, for the promise that heaven is waiting for me. This is the reason I sing. I will not be silent. Ooh, I'll testify of your grace. Jesus, forever my song will be you, only for you. For the cross that you bore and the debt that you paid, for the victory you won over death and the grave. Is the reason I sing, for the hope that you give and the joy that you bring, for the promise that heaven is waiting for me. This is the reason I sing. Yeah. So good, so good, you're so good to me. You bore and the debt that you paid, for the victory you won over death and the grave. This is the reason I sing, for the hope that you give and the joy that you bring, for the promise that heaven is waiting for me. Oh, this is the reason I sing, for the cross that you bore, you pay for the victory you won over death and the grave. This is the reason I sing, for the hope that you give and the joy that you bring, for the promise that heaven is waiting for me. This is the reason. It's the reason I say.
And I'm closer than you think, I promise. I promise. And though I won't let go, I won't let go. I see you right where you are, and I'm holding on to your heart. Tell me where were I looking, 'cause you weren't hard to find. Mercy opened up my eyes. Now I'm losing my religion to be loved like a child. I promise. I promise.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to chapel. I'm happy you all are here today. To begin, we have Matthew to share something.
Hello, everyone. My name is Matthew Wilhite. I'm a part of the RA team here on campus, and tomorrow night is Beacon Night. It's our hall music videos at 9 o'clock in the chapel, so go root on your hall in the music video that they made, and we're going to have a fun time, so hope to see you there.
Thanks, Matt. A couple of other brief things. This Saturday, there's a track meet at Lane. I believe they're beginning at 9-ish with throwers. Go out and support. It's a short drive. You only have to stay for a couple of events, really. But yeah, it's a good way to show your love for other Beacons. Lastly, the next night chapel slot will be Bushnell Speaks. That's next Wednesday at 8 in the Ross Evans Chapel. Sign up to talk about something. It doesn't have to be super deep or crazy. You can talk about music, video games, anything you want. There's QR codes around campus to sign up. And with that, would you all welcome up Lars?
All right. So guys, I get to serve as the Director of University Relations at Bushnell, and part of that is getting to be our Church Relations Director. And you might ask, like, what does that mean? Well, with us today in chapel are about 50 local pastors and church leaders from around the Willamette Valley in Oregon who are here to participate with us in our chapel today and then an afternoon session with Dr. Swoboda and our guest, who he's going to introduce in just a moment. And this event happens every year. It's been part of our 127-year history of having events on campus that resource the church. Conversations about faith and preaching and communication. And so this conversation, I think, is super timely. And so I'm going to invite Dr. Swoboda to come up and introduce our guest speaker and then also just say why he thinks this is a valuable topic for us to engage with, not only for our pastors, but also for you as students in a campus community. But as you see guests around, they might be wearing like a name tag with Sharpie on it. Just be friendly, greet them, ask them where they serve at church, and then also help them find their way to lunch afterwards and their sessions as you see them around campus. So, AJ, come on up.
Well, good morning. How are we doing? We doing all right? Yeah, good. I need a little feedback. It's about once a year, no more. About once a year, am I willing to wear my velvet jacket? I need a little bit of feedback. How are we doing? How are we doing? Okay, thank you. I was feeling pretty insecure this morning leaving my house, and my wife looked at me and said, "What's wrong with you?" And I said, "I get to go to Bushnell today, and I'm feeling good." Anyways, yeah. I remember years ago, I was down in Los Angeles, and I walked into an In-N-Out, and standing right in front of me at In-N-Out, buying a double-double, was Hulk Hogan. And I sort of, when he was standing in front of me, I was sort of hoping he'd do the Hulk Hogan thing, like rip his shirt off and be like, you know, bite into a Slim Jim and, or, you know, do Hulk Hogan stuff. If you remember who Hulk Hogan was, he was a famous wrestler. And I remember meeting him, and it was so weird because I'd spent my life like looking up to this guy. And he was very different in person than he was in the wrestling ring. And if you've ever had the opportunity to meet somebody that you look up to, it's often a scary experience because sometimes the people that you look up to in person aren't as great as you think they are. And then sometimes you meet the people that you look up to and they're better in person than you ever thought. I have my heroes. I know you do too. And today I get to introduce you to one of my heroes. Over the years, I have been deeply transformed by our guest speaker today. His name is Dr. Richard Beck. He's a Christian psychologist. He teaches at Abilene Christian University. He is a profound writer. His book, Stranger God, absolutely changed my life. I'm a different person because of this book. And the gift of getting to know Dr. Beck is that when you meet Dr. Beck, he's one person in a book, but man, he's even better in person. He's full of character and love. He loves God, and he loves the church. He and his wife, Jana, have two kids. They live in Abilene, Texas. Today, he's going to be sharing on the topic of faith in a polarized world. And I would love, if you would with me, to please welcome to the stage one of my heroes and soon to be yours, Dr. Richard Beck.
That was sweet. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. How are you? It's so good to see you. Let me just jump right in. If I was going to ask you a question, like who is the demographic groups in the United States, the demographic groups that experience the most stigma and prejudice, what would come to mind? And you might think, well, religion. I remember after 9/11, a lot of angry feelings toward Muslim populations. And it's true, throughout history, you know, religion has been a source of stigma and prejudice from one group to another. Obviously, in America, we would say maybe race. Race is going to be a location of stigma and prejudice. And we see all of those problems in our country today as well. And that's true throughout history, right? Race and ethnicity, along with religion, have been like probably the two biggest demographic groups that have experienced stigma and prejudice. But now there is a new, most stigmatized group in the United States that psychologists have been tracking over the last couple years. And so you know what it is? The most stigmatized groups in the United States of America are Democrats and Republicans. That psychologists have been tracing and watching the rise of what is called affective polarization. Affective polarization is different from issue polarization. Issue polarization is just the way you and I will fight about how to solve our country's problems. Like take immigration. We can look at immigration and say this is a country of immigrants. Unless we are Native Americans, we have all immigrated here at one point or another, as it says on the Statue of Liberty, bring me, you know, your tired, huddled masses. That's a value of ours as a country. And yet we also have concerns about making sure that that is done fairly and in proper good order. And so we debate as a country, how do we balance the competing goods about being welcoming to immigrants, but also making sure it's fair and just, right? We can talk about that. That's issue polarization, the way we disagree about issues. But affective polarization, and affective is like a psychological nerdy word, it means emotional polarization. Affective polarization are the feelings that we have toward our political opponents. The feelings that Democrats have about Republicans. Any Democrats in the room? Do you have any feelings? Republicans, and it's how Republicans feel about Democrats. Republicans in the room, do you have any feelings? Maybe you don't. I'm talking about other people, not Bushnell. I'm talking about other human beings who actually fight, you know, like why you see your family freaking out on Facebook, you know, like that's what I'm talking about. It's the hostility, the increasing hostility that we feel. It's the rising hatred that we have toward, you know, political opponents. That's emotional or affective polarization. And that is now at its highest peak we've ever seen it, to the point where we are more likely to show prejudice and discrimination towards political opponents than ethnic groups or religion. And you might be like, well, how would you know that? There's been this question that psychologists and sociologists have asked every year in America on a survey. And here's the question. The question is, imagine your son or your daughter was going to marry a person. How upsetting and distressing would it be if they married, let's say, a Muslim? And that's asked to a Christian. Like, how upsetting would that be if your child married a Muslim? And obviously, you know, people would say that might be really kind of distressing to me. And then we'd ask, like, what would it be like if your child, son or daughter, married somebody from a different ethnic group from your own? How upsetting would that be? But the question is also asked, how upsetting would it be if your son or daughter brought a Republican home for Thanksgiving? How upsetting it would be if they brought home a Democrat to Thanksgiving? And for the first time in America, that distress level is now higher than religion or ethnicity. You would rather your son or daughter marry into a different religious group or a different ethnicity than for them to marry out of your political party. And have you not seen this out there? That's what we're talking about. So what I want to do this morning is, as a psychologist, try to explain where this is coming from. Why is this happening from a psychological perspective? Where is this hostility and hatred and all this polarization coming from? This is not an exhaustive answer. It's just one answer. okay? And to get to my answer, I'm going to take you on a really weird journey. I'm going to talk about superheroes. I'm going to talk about fan culture and video games. And then I'm going to talk about conspiracy theories. Yeah, thank you. And then we're going to come back to politics, okay? So for a good 20 minutes, you're not going to know where I'm going. But let's begin with superheroes, shall we? And I'm very excited to bring up superheroes because from Texas, I've been fascinated by what happened in Seattle. So here I am in Oregon, about something that happened on the streets of Seattle. And maybe you're familiar with this, but in 2010, an article appeared in the Seattle newspaper that had this title, "Police Alerted to Superheroes Patrolling Seattle." That was the headline. And the first line of the article read, "Vigilante justice has come to Seattle, and the Cape Crusaders drive a Kia." That was the opening line. Is anybody familiar with about this time in Seattle history? So what had happened was people in Seattle had begun dressing up like superheroes. They donned masks and capes, and then they gave themselves names. Names like the Green Reaper, Gemini, Catastrophe, Thunder 88, and Phoenix Jones. And you can sign up. Like, you're like, man, this sounds like a great way to spend the weekend. You know, you can get your own costume and your own name, and you can join, right, the real-life superhero movement. On one of their websites, this is the way the real-life superheroes of the Rainy City describe themselves. A real-life superhero is whoever chooses to embody the values presented in superhero comic books. I guess they never read The Watchmen. Anyway, the values of the superhero comic books, not only by donning a mask or a costume, but also performing good deeds for the city they inhabit. Anyway, this whole phenomenon, if you're interested in going down this particular rabbit hole, and as a psychologist, I could not resist, there's a great podcast that the journalist David Weinberg did called The Superhero Complex. Anybody follow this podcast? It's a really good podcast about just like what was going on in Seattle when people were taken to the streets in capes. And, you know, and it wasn't just that they were kind of breaking up bar fights or calling the police if they saw something happening. Some people took it in a humanitarian direction, so they're dressed up like Batman and Superman, and they're reaching out to the homeless on the streets of Seattle, you know, handing out water and peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. And it raises an interesting question, like, why would you need to wear spandex to hand out sandwiches, okay? Why? And as a psychologist, that whole podcast, this whole phenomenon, reminded me of a book written in 1967 by a psychologist named Ernest Becker. And the title of the book was called The Denial of Death, and it's famous in my discipline because it won the Pulitzer Prize. And in the book, Becker says, modern people, like ours, like us, in the facing our eventual death, and perhaps a meaninglessness cosmos, like, right, a post-Christian world where, you know, we sense an existential vacuum out there, that creates in us a desire to live a significant and a meaningful life. And the way Becker described that thirst for significance and meaning in the face of an indifferent, silent cosmos, he described it as a hero system. That the fundamental psychological drive behind all of us is to live a heroic life. And with my students, I describe it as a hero game. That we all select for ourselves an arena of heroic action. My game, probably different from your game. It might be the game of Bushnell Athletics. It might be the game of your family of origin, like I grew up a Beck. And in that world of my family of origin, there is a kind of way of winning life. And maybe it's the game of, you know, your profession or your vocation or your job. Like, we all have this hero game. But sometimes these hero games manifest themselves in, like, weirdly pathological ways. Like, maybe your hero game can literally be dressing up like Batman and going to downtown Seattle. That would be a way of like really trying to live a heroic life. But if you look around our culture, like weird pathologies, you see this thirst for the heroic coming out like really sideways. So let me give you an example from like video games, video game culture. So have you heard of the big scandal in video games called Gamergate? Anybody hear about this? About 10 years ago. So this is what happened. In 2013, the video game developer Zoe Quinn made some criticisms about the content and the culture of video games. Her critique was mainly from a feminist perspective. She was kind of calling out the male-dominated culture of video games and also some of the portrayals of women in video games. And the video game community, in response to those feminist critiques, like lost its mind. They went at Zoe Quinn and these other critics, these other women who made these critiques, and they became the targets of this like vitriolic online harassment campaign. They faced, Quinn and others faced death threats and rape threats. Gamers shared nude photos of these women online and with their parents and their work colleagues. Their accounts were hacked. They were doxxed. Just horrific behavior for just raising some questions about video game culture. And Quinn said this when she attended her next video game conference. She said, "I used to go to game events and feel like I was coming home. And now I look around these rooms and I ask myself, are these the people that wanted to beat me to death?" Okay, does that sound a little pathological? Like, there's this weird asymmetry between the thing under consideration, which is video games, and death threats and rape threats. Like, how do you go from the triviality of the content and subject matter to this huge freak out? Like, what's driving that rage? Another example of this is the harassment campaign that kicked up around The Last Jedi. Now, I don't want to like mess with Star Wars fans today, because that is a very volatile group. Like, if you ever, you know, I said this once to my students, like, Star Wars fans are like one step away from being suicide bombers. They are really on the edge. Like, have you ever gotten a conversation with Star Wars fans about what is or is not canon? Right? Like, just you got to step away. Anyway, when The Last Jedi came out, the Star Wars fans, like, hated it. Okay? Do y'all remember this? They just hated it. And so death threats and harassment started being directed toward the actresses and the actors in The Last Jedi and toward Rian Johnson, who's the director. And he had this to say. He goes, like, before The Last Jedi, I had never had anybody hate me, right? Hatred on the internet. And so there we go. Like, you don't like you don't like a movie? You don't like a movie and you're gonna threaten to kill somebody? Like, what's the pathology behind what's going on here? Anyway, I found the analysis of a journalist, Frederick DeBoer. He made this analysis about Gamergate and Star Wars fans and a lot of weird pathologies we see in fan culture. And he traces it back to this idea of all of us having a superhero complex. But in this case, we're borrowing our heroic narratives through these products that we consume. So this is what DeBoer says about like what was driving all this. He says this. He goes, famously, in the 20th century, we saw the collapse of meaning. Between the wars of atrocities that were both horrifying and absurd, and the increasingly diminished role of religion in our lives, it has become harder to simply exist with a stable identity that you could trust and that you felt represented your real, true essence. And so into that chaos and that void of meaning came, of course, capitalism. Because if you can't generate real meaning and psychological security in your life, Amazon will be more than happy to sell it to you. Multiple times a day through movies and TV shows and video games, we are addictively absorbing content that contains morals and aesthetics and an attitude, the kind of things that feel like meaning. Unfortunately, this can have the effect of fooling oneself into thinking that these representations of meaning are the same thing as actually having meaning. Like the feeling that you are living a meaning-driven life by inhabiting these fictional products and universes. And so he goes on to say that this is going to be a mistake. He goes on and says this, I think a lot of nerds, and he's using that affectionately, I think a lot of nerds have fallen into the trap of thinking that liking a Marvel movie is the same thing as having a personality. They have so steeped themselves inside these products that they have come to think of them when they think of themselves. I love it so much, it must be me. And this is a mistake, because liking Star Wars simply is not a solid foundation for your personality. The human psyche, it needs more fundamental codes and commitments to work with, because Star Wars isn't under your control. And so if you give yourself up to it and somebody does something to it that you don't like, your whole world is going to get rocked as it was. Ask the people who hated The Last Jedi. And these properties, no matter how sophisticated they are, no matter how beloved they are, they just can't contain enough substance to anchor our sense of self. So that's kind of one pathology we see in the modern world, the way we are sold products and we inhabit products, and those products become pseudo meanings, receptacles of identities. That who I am, let me say it this way, who I am are the things I like. And as I gather my likes and my hobbies and my interests and my fan culture portfolio, these things are me, my identity. But if you give those things that much existential weight, if they become integral to your identity, then any criticism of a video game, any change, right, or displacement of the Skywalker family rocks your identity, because who you are the products you consume. Let me talk about conspiracy theories for a minute. On December 4th, 2016, around 3 p.m., Edgar Welch drove to the pizza restaurant Comet Ping Pong in Washington, D.C. with an AR-15 assault rifle and began firing in the pizza joint. Have you guys heard about this? Now, Welch had come to Washington, D.C. to Comet Ping Pong because he wanted to be a hero. He didn't shoot anybody. He wasn't there to kill anybody. As Welch later recounted in court documents, he said, I was there just, quote, because I wanted to do some good. Well, what good was he trying to do? Well, Edgar Welch had been going down the YouTube rabbit hole into a conspiracy theory called Pizzagate. Anybody heard of Pizzagate? Pizzagate was a forerunner of what eventually became QAnon, which was the conspiracy theory that drove a lot of people on January 6th on Capitol Hill, okay? So this is like pre-QAnon, but Pizzagate. And according to the Pizzagate conspiracy theory, elite Democratic leaders were engaged in child sex trafficking rings, and they were trafficking these children in the basement of this pizza restaurant in Washington, D.C. And Welch, watching all the, you know, online YouTube videos, was convinced that this was going on at this pizza place in Washington, D.C., and he draws a very logical conclusion. Somebody should go save the children. Amen? Like, if that's happening, somebody should go save the children. And so he lived in North Carolina. On the morning of December 4th, he grabbed his rifle, said goodbye to his wife and his two daughters, and he drove to Washington, D.C., entered the pizza restaurant, fired some shots, chased everybody out of the pizza joint, and began searching the building for the secret basement where the children were being held in sex slavery. What was the trouble with that, with that situation? Well, Comet Ping Pong didn't have a basement. The whole thing was fictional. And as he came out, the police showed up. He didn't find any children. He later said the intel on this wasn't 100% correct. Okay, the intel was a tad off that day. And so he retired. You know, he gave his gun away, and the police arrested him. And they said, "Why did you do this, sir?" And quote, he said, "My heart was breaking over the thought of all those young children suffering." His motivations that day were entirely heroic. And this is the thing I want to say about conspiracy theories. Why do people get trapped by conspiracy theories? And psychologists have studied this. And they say conspiracy theories kind of satisfy three great human needs. You know, one is epistemic, like intellectual needs. The world is scary and chaotic, and it seems like it's spinning out of control. And the conspiracy theory steps in and gives us, right, some answers. And because of those answers, even if they're delusional, they at least make the world seem understandable and predictable. Like, I know what's going on now. Before I did not, but now I see. It's, in fact, they call this in the QAnon conspiracy theory red pilling. You guys ever hear of red pilling? This goes back to Neo in the Matrix. Remember, Morpheus goes to Neo and says, "Here's the blue pill, here's the red pill. If you take the blue pill, you'll wake up to your middle, you know, you're like, you know, you'll be stuck in your dead end job under the mass delusion. But if you take the red pill, your eyes are opened and you will see reality for what it is." And so conspiracy theorists will talk about being red pilled. You take the conspiracy theory and your eyes are enlightened and you see what's going on. And that satisfies a deep human need to make life predictable. A second thing about conspiracy theories is they satisfy social needs. Conspiracy theories are persecuted minorities, okay? And they kind of bond together and they circle the wagons. And they kind of find community through some of those connections. But the third reason why people are attracted to conspiracy theories is the one I want to talk about, which are existential needs. And we've already been talking about this. That conspiracy theories help us step into a heroic narrative. When I step into the conspiracy theory, suddenly my dead-end life is charged with a high-stakes global war against the forces of evil and the forces of light. And I can step into the light and do battle with these forces that are trying to destroy America and her children and take over the world. And so that when you take the red pill, my life is suddenly imbued with heroic narrative and purpose. We step into, in its conspiracy theory, the superhero complex. And that charges life with great meaning. The trouble with a lot of our superhero complex, as you've seen in all of these situations, is they tend to produce in-group, out-group hostility. That there are good guys and bad guys, and that we have to stop the bad guys. Now, maybe stopping the bad guys on the streets of Seattle means dressing up like Batman and stopping the bad guys. Or maybe the bad guys are these feminists who are messing with our video game culture. Or maybe the bad guys are the people that are messing around with the Star Wars movies. Or maybe the bad guys are like elite Democrats trafficking children in pizza restaurants. But there are some bad guys out there. Will Storr, in his book, The Status Game, he says, you know what sits behind all of our hero games is this rivalry and competition and this hostility, and he calls it the universal prejudice. And we're all infected by this. We are all haters in some form or fashion. It varies depending on your particular superhero complex and mine. But typically, we see some dark forces out there, and we have this heroic self-identity that I am fighting those wicked, evil people. And so Soar goes on to describe this universal prejudice. He says, the resentments that our hero games can trigger are going to sour the story that we tell about the world. And it populates it with a ceaseless lineup of villains at whom we point and jeer and sing our songs of derision and all of our righteousness and envy. This universal prejudice is responsible for most of the misery and the anxiety and the exhaustion that we experience in the modern world. And it certainly causes most of the hostility that we feel towards others. And now I come back to politics. I want to argue that the reason why we are now seeing increased affective polarization, or what some psychologists call political discrimination, the villainization that we see across the political aisles, is due to the superhero complex. My argument is this: as Christianity fades in the West, as we step increasingly into a post-Christian culture, a heroic void has been created. And most of us now are filling that void, that need for the heroic, with a political hero game. That politics, party politics, is increasingly for us the receptacle of our most deeply held values and commitments. Okay? Politics is now the container of my identity because it represents my politics, who I am, what I believe in, even more so than Star Wars. Because Star Wars is just something I like, but my politics is what I believe. It's about values. It's about ethics. It's about right and wrong, good and evil. That used to be held by faith, that those ultimate things. But increasingly, as we no longer believe in God, politics has stepped in to be my moral. The way I'll describe it is this: for many of us, politics has become the arena of heroic moral action in the world. Okay? And to be clear, Republicans have their vision of what heroic moral action looks like, okay? Who the bad guys are, what the issues are, how to fight back the darkness. But for all my progressive social justice Democrat friends, they have their own version of heroic moral action, in which they are fighting a very different set of bad people. My point here is that both groups of people are putting on masks and capes and engaging in a fight against the wicked, okay, against the darkness. And so what I want to call us to here, faith in a polarized age, if this is true, then what I want to suggest as far as a correction to this polarization, because the deeper we go down and put our hero game in politics, the increasing divides there are. The reason why we can't reasonably talk about issues, about immigration or any other issue, where we're trying to balance competing goods, right? The reason why we can't grasp at a practical, pragmatic approach to politics anymore, where we used to kind of say, like, here's a value and here's a value. Like, think about something like vaccination. Not to get political, okay? Right? Like, is it true, everybody, that no governmental agency should tell you what to do with your body? Agreed? Right? That makes sense. Like, this makes sense. I don't think an authority figure should tell me what to put in my body. Is that a value? True. However, when we're facing a global health crisis where collective action is the only way to deal with it, does it make sense? Like, the only way to deal with a public health crisis is for the public to collectively act together. We might try to get everybody to, you know, act together, because if we don't act together, it won't work. Like, is that a value, that sometimes we all have to act together to solve collective problems? That's a value, isn't it? Public health. Now, how do you balance these two things? Okay. And there's got to be a way to balance it, isn't there? Reasonable people. Reasonable people can sit and say, okay, both of those are values, and so how do we protect bodily autonomy, but how do we also kind of, you know, get everybody collective action? Like, how do we solve this particular problem? You know what that used to be called? Politics. Used to be called politics, and we solved it through conversation and compromise and you know, and in America, it's an experiment. We try it, and if it doesn't work, what do? Try something else. It's practical and pragmatic. Is that how we approached COVID? No, we didn't approach it reasonably, because we're not approaching politics pragmatically. We're approaching it heroically. When those people are wicked. Step over here. Those people are wicked. And to have conversations with the devil is capitulation and compromise. That's how bad it's gotten. To talk is immoral. Because to talk is to compromise with the darkness. To even talk. And our reason why I think we've become so polarized is because the politics no longer represents how to represent different values, but they rather represent our identities. And the reason why we're freaking out every election cycle is because our identities are at stake, who we are, what we believe in. And so as we win or we lose these elections, our worlds get shaken. And sadly, amongst Christians, and because I'm going to push on something that might hurt a little bit here, is that even among Christians, our faith has been poured into these political receptacles. Our faith has become overly politicized, and that we are more, our Christianity is more about being a Democrat, or our Christianity is more about being a Republican than anything else. In fact, I mean, I was at my church. I have this little church that I worship with, and I remember in 2016 when Trump won. All my progressive friends came in just, they looked like Star Wars fans. They were just devastated, you know, just like the world has ended, you know? And so I preached a sermon to all my progressive friends. And the title of the sermon was called, How to Lose an Election. How does a Christian lose an election? How do you lower the stakes on that? Because the Bible's clear. We do not put our trust in princes. We do not. My existential weight is not in that election. It's in Christ. It's in the church. And this political thing is going to go up and it's going to go down. But this thing is solid and sure. I need to be non-anxious presence in my space. Well, then 2020 happened and all my conservative friends came in to church looking like Star Wars fans, you know? And so I preached the same sermon I preached to them 4 years earlier, how to lose an election. And one of the ways you learn to lose elections is you back out of the hero game of politics and into this thing we call the church. Now, some of you might be cynical. Is anybody cynical? I mean, I'm very cynical. So some of you might be saying, this is my conclusion. Some of you guys might be cynical. And you'll say, well, okay. You're asking me to back my hero game out of politics into religion. But aren't we just going to start using religion then as my new superhero complex? And we create the kind of wars of religion again. Aren't we just backing up the problem? Aren't we doomed to play the hero game of angels and demons? Are we condemned to do that? And I will say to all the cynics out there, I am worried about that too. Okay. But this is what I want to conclude with. I think if we can get ourselves back into the boat of faith rather than our political parties, I think we got a better chance at finding our way back to each other again. Okay? I'll say it this way. I think we have a better shot at this game of loving our enemies the closer we are to Jesus than we are to Washington, D.C. Does that make sense? Like, if I got to roll the dice on getting this hero game right, I'm going to bet that the closer you get your identity to Jesus, we've got a better shot at treating each other with respect than if we keep over-identifying with the whims and the fortunes of electoral politics every 4 years. That game will go up and it will go down. And if you are online, you know what I'm talking about, right? And then here's the other reason why I think we have a better shot with faith. Because I think faith has moral and psychological resources that your politics does not have. If you are over-identified with your politics right now, I'm going to suggest that you lack certain moral resources that can keep you steady in an increasingly polarized world. Well, like what? Like what kind of resources are you going to find in religion that you won't find in your politics? Here's a list. Mercy. Forgiveness. Grace. Gratitude. Hope. Peace. Reconciliation. Confession. Repentance. Humility. Kindness. Joy. Love. And even love for your enemies. I would rather have us in that sandbox where at least our easy hatred of each other has a chance of being interrupted. Because we are easy haters, increasingly so. And we need something in our lives that will make that easy hatred, right, it'll throw some sand into that machine. It will slow it down. It'll keep me restless. I want you haunted by Jesus. I want him to be a difficult companion for your politics. And it's in that difficulty where there's an ability to kind of say, like, aren't you kind of becoming a bit of a hater online, Richard? I need that voice in my head. And the only way I can get that voice in your head is if we increasingly find our way back to our true identity in Christ. Not a politicized version of Christ. Don't sneak your hero game in through the back door. But the Christ of the Sermon on the Mount. That one, the real one. And I think if we get closer to him, we might have a chance to be non-anxious Christians in a polarized world. We might have a chance, a shot. Listen, I kind of think it's an outside shot. Okay? I don't trust us at all. I trust God, though, to surprise us. But I don't trust us at all. We are not good vehicles for love in the world. But I have a suspicion that God might show up. And that's my only hope. So I have some hope that if we can step into Christ, we might have a chance to not just become non-anxious Christians, but non-violent Christians. And so, my brothers and sisters, it is not too late to step away from your hero game. It is not too late to step away from electoral politics. It is not too late to step away from being a Republican or a Democrat. It is not too late to be a Christian.
Well, I hope you were blessed today by what Richard had to say. And I want to give just a little bit of an announcement for our folks that are guests. We're going to be having lunch across the street in the Booker Room. And so if you don't know where that is, you're going to cross with the crosswalk over here across 11th, and you'll go across the quad kind of over to the left. You'll see us following over there. And then for faculty and staff, you're welcome to join us for the Q&A time afterwards in the Evans Chapel at 1 o'clock. And now I think we're going to stand and do our benediction. As God has authored an eternal story and Jesus has lived a great story, so with the Spirit, I will trust this true story. Share the stories that are true. Thanks for helping with the chairs.